On October 11th, 1889, two line workers for the Western Union Telegram Company in Buffalo, New York, were sent to cut six apparent dead wires off a telegraph pole in the middle of town. After climbing the 50-foot pole, one of the men, John Feeks, made contact with two wires, sending a current of electricity blasting through his body. While his partner fled the scene, Feeks' body began to thrash uncontrollably, getting even more entangled in the wires. As his body began to burn, a large crowd gathered around to witness a horrific scene. 40 minutes later, Western Union was able to cut the power and get his body down. Feeks died on initial contact. This was by no means an isolated incident. In the early days of the electrical industry, linemen like Feeks became a vital part of America, providing the nation with communication lines and electricity. For Americans, having electricity in their homes was a modern miracle. For the linemen who made this possible, however, it was a much different story. In 1890, the mortality rate for line workers was an obscene 50%. Line work was dangerous work. Linemen had to endure everyday risks of falling, weather, and electrocution. Along with this, electricity was not well understood and safety regulations were non-existent. As America began to explore the frontier of electricity, many brave linemen were on the frontier of fighting for workers' rights, pushing for the creation of safety codes and establishing safer industry practices. One man who did all three of these things is often overlooked: George Llewellyn Brooks. Brooks was many things: a lineman, a labor activist, an innovator, and a man who helped form the line industry we know today. In such a dangerous field, unionization was both an inevitable and critical tool which linemen used to have their voices heard. Participating in union activities in the late 19th and early 20th century was a dangerous endeavor. Employers, not wanting to concede to their workers' concessions which could cut into their earnings, would often hire union busters in order to dispel attempts at organizing. Along with this, a lack of workers' protections meant that employers could fire suspected union employees at any time. Even worse, these workers could find themselves blackballed, meaning that other employers would refuse them jobs due to their union connections. Despite these dangers, linemen were no strangers to risk. As the field grew, so too did workers' attempts to organize. As soon as 1870, several small electrical unions would be created, most of which would disband after a few months or years. The National Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, or NBEW, was formed in 1891, and it quickly became the most successful electrical labor union. Union dues were used to provide a funeral benefit to families, which, due to the hazards of the industry, almost bankrupted the organization. In 1899, the NBEW became the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, or IBEW. George Lew Brooks grew up on his family's farm near Lansing, Michigan. Much like his later life, little is known about Brooks' childhood. At the age of 12, Brooks dropped out of the fourth grade and found work at a lumber camp in northern Pennsylvania. As he grew older, he soon found work on the railroad as a brakeman, a job which found him traveling across the country. One city which he often stopped at was Seattle, Washington, where he would eventually begin his line working career. In 1908, Brooks would be hired by the City Light Company as a lineman. Soon after, he would join IBEW Local 77, an affiliate of the IBEW which represented Washington State. Despite the fact that this was nearly 20 years after the IBEW's formation, taking part in union activities was still extremely dangerous. Meetings for local were often held in the woods in order to avoid so-called goon squads hired by employers. It was here where Brooks made one of his first major contributions to the line industry. He began spearheading an effort in the local to draft out electrical safety legislation, something that was unheard of at the time. In 1913, Brooks was elected president of Local 77, making him the figurehead of the union. Soon, Brooks and his fellow members took to Washington State's Capitol Olympia to lobby for their bill, Senate Bill 422. At this time, there were no state or federal laws regarding electrical worker safety regulations, making the spell radical for its time. Luckily, Washington State Governor Ernest Lister was sympathetic to workers' rights, and on March 20, 1913, he would sign the 1913 Safety Standards for Electrical Workers Act, putting Washington State on the frontier of electrical workers' rights. However, Brook's victory wouldn't last for long, as right after the act's passing, he was fired from the City Power and Light Company. When he went out to search for other employment, he soon discovered that he had been blackballed by all utility employers on the West Coast. Brooks knew the risks, yet he sacrificed his career and his family's well-being to improve safety conditions for his fellow Lyman brothers. His term as president of Local 77 ended in 1914, where he would return to work as a brakeman for the Northern Pacific Railroad. In 1917, Lou inherited his family's farm and returned to Michigan, where he got back into the line trade for Consumers Power Co. in Lansing. He became a well-respected employee, often being consulted by management and acted as the foreman of several crews. Yet despite this position of high respect, Brooks was very vocal and critical about the company's lacking safety practices. Because of his continued protests, Brooks was terminated from Consumers Power Co. in 1931. After sacrificing his job yet again for safety, he eventually found work as a lineman for WPA, where he was placed with inexperienced crews. In order to ascend and descend poles, linemen used to have to hug and climb the pole like so. However, in 1850, hooks began being developed. These would be worn on a lineman's leg who would stab them into the pole in order to climb. However, these early designs had several problems. For one, if the user was too short, the hooks would act like a leg splint. Having restricted leg motion over 30 feet in the air wasn't only inconvenient and uncomfortable, but dangerous. Since 1912, Brooks had been drafting and perfecting a design for hooks which a user could adjust to fit their height preferences. In 1931, Brooks told his son, George F. Brooks, about the design he had been working on for nearly 20 years. Brooks' son was taking a drafting class at the time and suggested to his teacher to let him draft out his father's hook design for class credit. Brooks filed the patent on February 2, 1933, and immediately began searching for an investor to help him create dies for his hooks. Brooks needed an investment of nearly $500, or approximately $11,500 in today's money. Despite this, Brooks' efforts were tireless, and he eventually convinced the owner of Lansing's Melling Drop Forge, Mr. J.W. Wofford, to have his men create dies. On May 1st, 1934, Brooks' Lyman Climber's patent was approved, 50 days after his death on March 12th, 1934. Brooks didn't live to see the revolution his adjustable hooks would cause, which has since become an industry standard and has allowed linemen on the job site to be safer when completing their work. Brooks was on the frontier of line safety as well, which at multiple points came at the cost of his job. Brooks' 1913 Electrical Safety Act set the precedent for other worker safety legislation to follow suit, such as OSHA in 1970. Because of this, the 1 in 2 linemen which died in Feeks' time has been reduced to 12 in 100,000 line workers. This is still 12 too many, but organizations such as the IBEW continue to fight for electrical workers and thrive. Brooks helped lead the union in a time when the frontier was dangerous. IBEW currently has a membership of 775,000 people. IBEW Local 77, the affiliate that Brooks once ran, holds the annual George Brook Safety Initiative, the safety conference named in his honor. Yet, despite this, Brooks is seldomly remembered for the frontiers he conquered. Yet his actions helped form the line industry we know today. He helped make it so people who risk their lives to keep our world running can feel safe on the job site. He helped make it so the people who keep our lights on can go to work, confident they will see their families when they get home. The frontiers George Brooks helped conquer brought the industry to the state of modernization and safety it's at today.